Hello and welcome back to Los Angeles, where we're playing Heroes of the Storm for the Heroes of the Dorm Tournament. I am Trixler, and with me is, of course, Sean Jester. Delaney, how are you, Jester?
Oh, I'm doing absolutely fantastic. I mean, with already so many fantastic matches under my belt, how couldn't I be so fantastic?
Gotta agree with you, man. I was watching back there some amazing matches back and forth already, and I'm ready for more. But if you are unaware of what exactly Heroes of the Storm is, we've got a quick video to let you know what's going on if you just joined us.
Welcome to Heroes of the Storm, Blizzard Entertainment's action-packed team brawler. Players can choose from a variety of Blizzard heroes, each with unique strengths and weaknesses, to create five-player team compositions that support versatile strategies. These strategies are then put to the test on a diverse set of battlegrounds, each with their own unique objectives. Hire the ghost pirate Blackheart, summon a powerful grave golem. Every battleground is different and presents a unique environment for competition. However, the criteria for victory is constant. Destroy the opposing team's core. Heroes will grow in power and talent over the course of a single game as they take out minions, enemy fortifications, and of course, the opposing team's heroes. Your effectiveness at teamwork and collaborative play will make or break you.
And that's a quick recap on what exactly Heroes of the Storm is. Now, of course, it's a little bit more in-depth. There's a lot more stuff going on. But overall, we've about 3 to 4 matches in now, Jester.
Three matches into our fourth.
Yeah, so we're looking pretty good overall. Remember, we are currently in the top 16. So let's go ahead and check out the entire format for what exactly our players have to do to keep moving forward. Right now, as you can see, we're currently in the top 16. We've gone from the top 64 all the way down to that. We'll be going into the Epic 8 next, which eventually we'll be getting ourselves into the Heroic 4, and which will have an amazing match, of course.
And of course, you know, past that, the grand finalists with the top two teams, and that's going to be the two contenders that are looking for this free tuition, some very cool prizes, and the right to call themselves the Heroes of the Dorm.
Yeah, and of course, there is the prizing as well. All of our teams have been awarded a majority of great prizes. Mm-hmm. If you're in the tournament at all in any way, shape, or form, you, of course, get an amazing beta key. You get an exclusive in-game portrait that showcases one of our heroes, Asmodan. And then, of course, if you follow up into the top 64, players will be getting a $40 Battle.net balance that they can use on any Blizzard Entertainment game. You can also use it on skins and heroes in Heroes of the Storm.
Absolutely.
And then, of course, the top four teams, these are the Heroic Four, they'll be getting a nice gaming system from CyberPower PC featuring components from Intel, Gigabyte, Roseville, and of course hardware from HyperX and SteelSeries.
And as I mentioned, winning team tuition for your college career. This is definitely one of the biggest, if not the biggest, collegiate esports event, and it couldn't be happier that it's with Heroes of the Storm.
Yeah, can't go wrong, man. So overall, what has been your favorite matches in today's bracket?
I gotta say, I mean, Arizona came out strong in their matches. They definitely had some really solid strategy. They took it 2-0. I'm a little surprised at the strength of Western Ontario, because they took a 2-0 over top of Assumption. They're definitely a little bit closer to my heart, as I am an Ontario native. But at the same time, I mean, they were really surprising. It's really good to see them into that Epic 8. And then, of course, we did just see Texas A&M take on the Florida Gulf Coast. And I got to say, that when we saw the Sonya, when we saw the Nova picks, we just went nuts. We're like, what are we about to see? And it was a really cool comp from them. But in the end of it, Texas A&M, definitely the powerhouse show.
Yeah, no, I definitely was enjoying that game as well. I know in the background we were all yelling the ooh-ah when Sonya was picked.
That's what you got to do. It's the dream.
That's right, man. And they had some amazing plays here and there. Nice dream overall. Of course, that was a fantastic match to watch. Nova being pulled out in this tournament is crazy as well. I'm hoping to see more tournaments as well, or more crazy picks as we go throughout the next couple of rounds. I believe we have a total of 5 more left for us to check out.
Well, I mean, 3 plus 5 definitely seems like 8, and that will create our Epic 8 for next weekend. As all this live coverage brought to you by Heroes of the Dorm. It's a fantastic event. And now we're going to actually take a little bit of a veering off here, and we're going to showcase some of the more internet celebrities and YouTubers that we asked to do some predictions here for us in Heroes of the Dorm.
Yeah, looking at it, you got Jesse Cox there in the top left corner, Jimmy Wong, Malik Forte, and Matt Sahinki. And overall, look at it, it looks like Jesse Cox is barely edging out Sahinki.
Barely, but it's a higher win percent rate there. for Matt Sohinki. So that's going to be very neck and neck. Malik Forte with 300 points at the 48% rate. And unfortunately, it is Jimmy Wong just trailing. Jimmy Wong was part of the show matches a few months ago here for Heroes of the Storm. I'm a little surprised to see him a little that low.
Man, he's going to be able to come back, no problem. I know he's talking about it on the hashtag Storm the Dorm, which you guys at home should be talking about as well if you would like to jump in and join the conversation. So, Jimmy Wong, you got this, man. I believe you can come back. And Jesse Cox, I know you want to be in the lead, man. He's a guy that loves winning things, that's for sure.
He absolutely adores Heroes of the Storm. If you guys do check him out, I mean, there's so much content. He has so many conversations about it. So him edging out Sohinki, that's a really close neck-and-neck race. We'll have to check in with him a little bit later to see after some more matches what the current standings will be. But that comes later because we have match number four almost ready to go here.
Yeah, let's go ahead and check out the teams that will be showcasing you for the next round in the tournament. Looking at it, it's going to be the Mad Banners versus the Tricky Turtles. It'll be the University of Illinois at Urbana and then, of course, the University of Connecticut. So can't wait for this match. It's looking pretty great overall. The Tricky Turtles is quite an interesting name, that's for sure.
The Tricky Turtles, the alliteration is strong. I'm a little surprised I didn't see the Mad Hatters. But the Mad Banners instead. I wonder if that's actually a reference to something else in the Blizzard universes. Because we do see banners throughout a lot of the universes. They're definitely throughout some of our battlegrounds here as well. If you go to the website as well, I mean, there's banners everywhere. So maybe there's something about those banners that are just mad.
All right, well, let's go ahead and check out the Mad Banners of roster here. Going to go ahead and jump on in. Here are the players that you'll be watching in this tournament. Kikisho, Wrath, Mr. Burks, Sadarha, and Dayan, I believe.
Sadaharu,
oof.
Yep.
Oof, that's going to be a hard one for me. All right. Yeah, and it looks like the Mad Banners will be playing, of course, underneath these names. So looking into it, can't wait to see what exactly they'll be playing. Let's go ahead and check out the other team pretty soon here, as they'll be going against the Tricky Turtles.
The Tricky Turtles, yeah. I mean, I have these big images of ninjas and turtles. We all know where that goes. But Monkey Lumps, Chirono, Batosai, Dan Lee for three, which is fantastic. And RSPD. He didn't get the RSVP, but it is instead the PD there. Yeah. So those are going to be the five represent here from Connecticut. And you know, going into this bracket, not a lot of people actually put faith when they did their brackets coming into the round of eight. We have actually a 12% pick rate for Illinois and a 10% for Connecticut.
Wow.
So that's actually really even. I'm not entirely too sure which way these games go. Series will go.
It could swing either way, but hopefully they can actually prove themselves to the rest of the community, those that made the brackets. Let them know, hey, you guys should have voted for us. Of course, you want to get a couple of fans on your side, so potentially they'll have a lot of people cheering for them, even if it might be a little bit now. Going into the Epic 8, whoever wins, of course, will have a nice little lead segue into it.
Yeah, well, it's got to be one of these two teams because only the victors will advance. And let's talk a little bit now about what we're about to see. This next map is going to be, once more, Cursed Hollow, one of the more mainstay maps here in Heroes of the Dorm. We're going to talk a little bit about what you're going to see right here.
All right, so jumping straight into Cursed Hollow. You've seen it a couple of times, but if you're just now joining us, do know that there are three lanes throughout the entire map here that teams will have to, of course, be on. Curse your enemies, take their health points down to 1 HP, and stop their turrets from shooting, and you can push them down. Make sure to collect those tributes. You need a total of three to actually even unlock the curse, and then from there, you can just follow up. There are a total of six mercenary camps that teams can grab. Those mercenary camps will, of course, fight for you, push down infrastructure, and really help out in lane, so you want to grab them, especially that big boss that you just saw being picked up. Overall, team's going to want to try and kill off the core to end the game, and whoever does that first will win the series.
And that is exactly how you do it, Trixler. So we've seen strategies that are curse-dependent. We've seen multiple Grave Golem pushes from some of these teams before as well. Some of them just straight-up fight. That's what they want to do. They want to brawl in the Nexus, and it has won out for them in their favor. Typically, though, the team that wins Cursed Hollow has actually won the second map as well, despite the fact it's not their choice. But we're keeping it even, and everybody has to prove their worth first on Cursed Hollow.
Yeah, we'll have to see all the strategies that will be pulled off on Cursed Hollow. There are so many, as Jester alluded to, but it looks like the draft is already underway. We'll find out what exactly our teams will playing in terms of heroes. Jumping into it, the first pick here. Looks like it's going to be a Jaina.
The return to the 100% first pick. Although last round, again, it was the Tyranda. That was the bigger preference from both teams. Today, however, Sadaharu, will be that Jaina. But, ooh, this is a gutsy pick from the Turtles.
Very bold pick already going straight into Illidan. Illidan requires a solid amount of coordination from your team, but he's also kind of hard to dive into Jaina. Jaina has the CC, the slow, the potential burst to really deal with him if he's not being careful, and then it looks like a ball of follow-up. So the Tricky Turtles trying to nab some damage right away with their draft.
Yeah, Chirono playing out Vala. We said this time and again. She's a very mainstay ranged DPS. She was actually the most picked hero in all of the rounds to date. If you go all the way back up to 889 teams, now down to the Super 16, Vala is ever present in a lot of these team matches. I think with a pick rate of over 10%, then that is a lot of games.
Yeah.
Even you apply that to just how many matches we had to play from these teams. So on the flip side, Kakisho on Mad Banners picks up an Uther. That's a really nice deny pick, not only to Illidan, but it's also going to be trying to attempt to control him.
Uther just solid overall and great to have matched up with Jaina. Nice heals overall, really, to try and save that Jaina from falling out of the fight, because if she does go down pretty quickly, your whole entire team composition kind of crumbles. We have Mr. Berkey's grabbing Tychus right away. Nice amount of damage for him as well. And Tychus, I believe, this is one of the first times you're actually seeing him if you're watching the stream, and he brings a lot of damage and can also turn into a giant robot, if you will, to help out with the damage.
Domo arigato, and all that fun stuff. But yeah, Tychus, you're right. This is the first time that we're going to see him. So let's talk a little bit about him. We see the Rhaegar on the flip side, but we've seen Rhaegar before. Want to really make sure that you guys know what to expect here from Tychus. So he does have a myriad of abilities ready to go, and he's especially effective against an Illidan. It's probably one of the big ideas behind picking him, at least this early on. Overkill, frag grenade, run and gun. Not only will he use that gigantic gun to great effect, but the frag grenade as well is also an interrupt. It's also a displacement. It can really stop a combo from happening. The run and gun for mobility, and I'm not entirely too sure which way we're going to go here. Draken Laser Drill is a gigantic laser that's going to start bringing down the pain on someone. But the Commandeer Odin, that is the robot skill you're talking about.
Yeah, the Draken Laser Drill can be really solid on Cursed Hollow overall, just because you can have the tributes pop up, you throw down the laser. It's great for zoning, creating a lot of safety, and it's also just great against Illidan, because Illidan has to dive into a team fight for him to do any damage in any way, shape, or form. So
absolutely,
Tychus having there as more of a deterrent is great. Well, Monkey Lungs did pick up Rhaegar, as we mentioned earlier. Great healer. He has burst healing with his ancestral healing ability. Just nice CC as well to help out with trying to keep people back. He could dive in with wolf form. Great pickup.
Ooh.
And then, looks like we're going to have Stitches picked up.
Now, this is the first time that we have not actually seen a Diablo or an ETC in the draft, and there's another warrior picked up before them. But a little bit of history. Stitches, he's definitely a very solid warrior, but he has a hook. And yeah, that's the big pressure point that we're going to be going for here for the Tricky Turtles. If you actually throw out the chain and hook and you bring somebody come back to you, that's a big opportunity for the teams to collapse upon the newly caught prey. Even later on, we get a fishing hook, which extends the range. That's one of the big power gains for a late game Stitches. So we're going to try to put up a lot of pressure here for the Tricky Turtles with that hook and with that pick. But that might actually leave them a little bit weaker on the front line.
Yeah, they're going to have to be really on top of the playmaking. That's what Stitches does. He makes plays for his team. So it's going to be on top of Battosis here to really make those plays for his team. Looking over to the Mad Banners once again, Diane is going to be getting Tassadar, it looks like. Tassadar is just great for, again, keeping Jaina alive. We've seen a lot of times players or opponents are trying to jump on that Jaina with the shields and the type of potential force walls that we saw a couple games ago. You can really defend against your character being picked off. And then ETC will round it out. Nice strong front line here for Mad Banners with, of course, ETC and Uther.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, the ETC, the Diablo, we've seen a lot of them. So it's not a surprise to see now the Elite Torn Chieftain come into the front line needs of the Mad Banners. Wow. Now this is interesting. The Tricky Turtles with the last pick on the Lost Vikings. We've seen this in the first game scenario of our first matchup with Western Ontario. And they had a player that really did do the good strength things that the Vikings do. Can we see the Tricky Turtles actually use them to the same effect that we saw in the previous match?
We'll have to see. The RPSD playing on the Lost Vikings is a big indicator of his confidence and his skill. It's a hero that not only they can be controlled, they have three individuals that have to be controlled by one player. So you will have to be jumping around the map a lot. You'll have a lot of things coming at you. And of course, you have three individual characters that you have to micro left and right, which means they, of course, have to pull them back, get them into the fights. It's a lot of things to focus on, if you will. So RPSD, obviously looking pretty confident. He's breaking this out in the tournament. It's one of the harder skill heroes in the game. But I'm looking forward to it, man. It can bring a lot of damage to the fight. And it's also a hero that the opposing team doesn't want to focus because they could potentially be chasing three individuals around, which could really distract them completely.
And the big thing there as well, each Viking isn't worth a full hero death. If you ever see the takedown counts in the bottom, they got some decimal places. Don't freak out. It is just how they play out. There's three of them, and they do add up to almost one by the end of it. But together, they will be those Lost Vikings. Flip side, though, who do we got on blue?
All right, Jester, jumping straight into it. You can see the blue team circling the core here. You have Dan on Tassadar, Setahuru on Jaina, Rath, Mr. Berkeys, and Kakisho really just putting this entire lineup here. So blue team looking great, and the Tricky Turtles on the other side.
Oh, man, the Kakisho squad
the
right there. Yeah, man, some of these dances are absolutely fantastic. But Dan Lee for three, Battlesai, Monkey Lumps, Chirono, and RPSD will be making up the Tricky Turtles, which hopefully will not be a tricky name for us as we keep going through this one. But, you know, the team here from Connecticut, as I said, is actually edging out in terms of picks a little bit from some of those user-generated brackets. We'll have to see if they can live up to that hype.
So you see here, the Tricky Turtles, three of them are in a bush. They're looking for Batto here to hit a hook, which means he can pull somebody up and get a quick kill or a quick takedown early on. Looks like the blue team, the Mad Banners, though, are playing very defensive in the middle lane. They're hugging their walls. They're looking for Stitches. As soon as they see him, as you can see here now, they go ahead and move to the lanes. They always want to make sure they have an eye on that character if possible, especially in the early game.
Just like what we saw with Nova with the roams in the previous, you don't really know where she is, but you do want to keep that eye on top of Battlesai right there, because a hook or a pull in especially a lot of the places in Cursed Hollow. This was the map, this was the battleground that put Stitches in the meta. He was a big pick on this battleground because there's so many places he can trap opponent heroes between walls, between trees, between other heroes, and that leads you into a really good situation for a takedown.
For sure. Let's go ahead and check out the top lane and get an idea of what the other teammates are doing for our players. Chirino and RPSD trying to soak this lane, just grab as much experience as possible. Right now it is 2-2, so teams are very, very even. Chirino and Setahuru will have a weird trade-off. They're both characters that can't take much damage, but they can put out a lot of damage very quickly. So if Chirino can dodge some kind of shot that's thrown his way, oh wait, Wrath is coming in. There goes a displacement grenade. Chirino in trouble, being focused down, and that's the first takedown of the game.
Yeah, it's not going to be a pretty picture there, as we do have that first takedown. Now the Olaf on that that Viking RPSD, he did bring him back out of the danger zone. That actually could have been a potential kill in a bit. But where are the other Vikings, Trickster? They are actually holding down this bottom lane. RPSD has to split his focus between top and bottom and manage both sets of those Vikings, not only against the Tassadar, which is played out by Dion here, but that Jaina into the top there as well. And that's something that's a little hard to do in some of these higher brackets.
Yeah, the Vikings have to be careful, especially in the early games. But we have hit over 2 minutes now, which means a tribute will be spawning really soon for our teams. In the middle lane, we still see Dan Lee for three, and Beto and Monkey Lump just pushing that lane. As now, finally, the tribute has spawned in the top right corner, and already the Mad Banners are in position to grab it.
5 seconds, and that will materialize. What kind of positioning are we going to see here from the Banners? We got four of their heroes up into the top. It looks like Tassadar will veto this fight. He's going to stay down there. So this is as strong as we get for the Banners. Can they actually put up enough of a front? There goes the hook from Battlesai. It only lands on top of Kakisho, but the big damage is on top of the Rigar as he drops. The heals are now out of the fight for the Tricky Turtles. They still will be able to put up a little bit of poke here, which will stop this tribute. But overall, in terms of a big full-fledged engage, they will have to retreat.
And Beto goes for another hook once again. The Mad Banners need to be careful here. Remember, they only have four members of the total five here. They are at a small disadvantage. But even with the disadvantage, Mr. Berkeys is able to grab that tribute. And the entire time in the very far bottom lane, the Mad Banners had one player, Dayon, just pushing this lane the entire time. He got a little bit of damage on the infrastructure as well and looks to keep the pressure up.
Now, there is a popular strategy with Vikings play. You spread them out into the three lanes when a tribute comes. If everybody on the opponent's team, if everybody from the Mad Banners had gone to that tribute, it is now the job of the Tricky Turtles to try to delay as much as they can.
Dan Lee coming down, trying to get on Dayon, but he has a nice ability where he can kind of become invincible for a couple of seconds, yep, able to get out of that lane. Let's check out the mid lane, just get an idea of what's going on there as we see Monkey Lumps grabbing the mercenary camps. RPSD just sitting behind the turret.
He's been forced out. That is a scary three-man composition against him.
That it is. Let's go ahead and head to the mercenary camps down the bottom right. As Tricky Turtles are grabbing these giants, remember, these mercenary camps will fight for them. They will push in the bottom lane if they can grab it. They have to stand on the yellow circle that will spawn right after taking out the giant. There it is. And now they'll be heading in the bottom lane. Overall, game is pretty close, though, Jester.
Yeah, but it's, I mean, we've seen this before. You get those Sea Giants on that second tribute, and if it's top, you're going to get a lot of value for them bottom. Unfortunately, it is not. The enemy team is here. Battlesai is not looking so healthy anymore. Wrath, unfortunately, I don't think he has it in the bank. He really needs to get that power slide forward. We got the heals, though. Monkey Lups is going to keep him alive, and Wrath could not finish off that takedown. And it will actually still be that tribute there. Nobody had actually committed to it. They were really looking for these takedowns.
Beto comes around. He gets hook on Sada here. He's low on HP, but Wrath and Mister show up just in time to save Jaina from getting in trouble. And it looks like the tribute has still not been secured. Immediately, one of the teammates jumped to the aid of the Mad Banner's Jaina.
Now, again, this is what I was saying. The Vikings are in all three lanes. As long as we can keep the Mad Banners from getting this tribute, you're going to see an experience lead develop for them. And so far, you're about to see level 8 applied to the Tricky Turtles because of that soak. They don't have as much presence at tributes, but they can use these early ones before that very important Curse one, which is up next, in order to try to grab that level 10 heroic faster.
Yeah, the goal here is for the Tricky Turtles to get to level 10 before their opponents. They want to grab that heroic ability that gives them an extra ability, a nice amount of team fight before the Mad Banner gets it. If they are able to do so, they'll be able to win a team fight and, of course, grab their first tribute of the game. But as it stands, the Mad Banners are ahead 2 out of 3 tributes.
Now going back and forth, where is this next tribute actually going to be spawning? It could be anywhere at this point. Could be top, could be bottom. And so we do have some mercenaries going back and forth. We still got Dan down here. He's actually done a really good job. There's no gate in this bottom lane up against the Tricky Turtles. That makes it very hard for RPSD to move forward because Dan would start attacking him, and there's no safety net for that Viking. And the Viking, as a third of a hero, does not have a normal hit point.
All right, the third tribute is here. Unfortunately for the Tricky Turtles, they have not gotten level 10 yet. They have to be on point. They have to deny this tribute. But already they have pressure in the middle lane as mercenary camps are pushing, and we now have Kakisho and Mr. Berkey's coming down to try and help with the tribute grab.
As well as Wrath. Yeah, it's again going to be this four-man pressure here. That's a hook there from Battlesai. It will stop this tribute once more. Monkey Lumps throwing down his totem and putting a lightning shield on it. That will stop anybody from gathering out this tribute. And there's the Oracle from Diane. He can now see everything around here. There's no secrets from the Tricky Turtles. They don't have that heroic yet, but Chiruna is going to be really low. It's a great power slide there from Wrath. You see now Diane lead for 3 running the other way. RPSD has actually brought the Vikings to bear for this tribute, and still on the other side, Battlesai with those hooks.
Jester, the red team, the Tricky Turtles are very close to hitting level 10. They want to try and delay as long as possible and hit that heroic ability. I don't know if they can do it. It's seconds away, but we have Kakisho grabbing the tribute. A nice delay from Battle here.
There it is.
And finally, Tricky Turtles hit level 10. Are they going to engage? You see Dan Lee charging in, and now the blue team, Mad Banners, realize they're level 10. We have to pull back. Mm-hmm. That's how much of a threat level 10 is here. And Tricky Turtles, through some curious strategy, able to get it to work out.
Well, it worked out in the end for the Tricky Turtles. They were able to finally get a tribute into their pocket, and they have denied the curse here to the Mad Banners. Mad Banners, very smart. They pulled back. They said, whoa, we cannot fight that. We need our own power-ups at 10, and there they go. They finally get that. The next tribute is not going to be so kind to either team. Whoever gets the better positioning.
Chirino gets a nice takedown there with the help of RPSD. The Water Elemental is trying to break her down, but unfortunately that will not be occurring as a Jaina was taken out. That means she just can't control it and the AI will take over. But Kakisho heads up the top lane here and wants to make sure that he's grabbing his experience. But you're right. The next tribute is very, very important for the Mad Banners. And they now have the tools, since they're equal levels now, in a sense, they're able to actually go there and fight. So here we go. Tribute in the top left corner. Let's see how the Mad Banners take it.
Big thing. That Water Elemental has a 50-second cooldown left.
That is
not going to come to bear in this fight. That is a big power dip for that Jaina player, for Sadaharu. I mean, he's going to be able to come back and still participate in this engage, but without that heroic, it's just going to be hitting a little less hard. There's the laser. They're going on top of Monkey Lumps, who's in the very far forward. The Ancestral Healing just has a little bit of a delay, and we were able to take him down before that delay had occurred. So RPSD and crew, they're just going to give it up, and that is not where we want to be for the Tricky Turtles. They put so much into that gamble for the heroics, and then they just lose it just like that.
And And the blue team, the Mad Banners, will take this advantage and roll with it. They're going to the top lane. They're going to break down some turrets and some gates. They're going to try and keep the pressure up. The entire red team for the Tricky Turtles, except for the Vikings, are up in the top lane. They're trying to defend, but Beto gets caught here. He's in trouble. The Dance from Wrath is going to secure a quick takedown. He's still going to keep dancing, and this will be a fort.
Every good concert deserves an encore, and with that takedown on top of Battlesite, yeah, that's going to be it for the defense. They do not have their frontliner. They don't even have that hook pressure here either, and that's why we can be so bold here from Mad Banners. They always got to be keeping it in the back of their mind. There could be a hook. What angle will it come from? Who needs to stand in front? Without that pressure, you can see they take down the top. They're going for the Great Golem.
Yeah, they're going to try and grab it. The Vikings are on their way, but they're all the way down in the bottom lane. This Golem is being focused down. Dan Lee 4-3 is coming in for a massive engagement. His heroic metamorphosis can be very powerful here. Tarina gets caught, though, by a Divine Storm. Oh, no, he gets taken down. Dan Lee going in for the engagement. There's the metamorphosis. He hits a couple of members. Mr. Berkey's in trouble in the top right corner, but Dan Lee is forced to retreat. The Vikings show up, but can they do anything?
Well, they're going to get into that boat, but it is a killable boat. Up and down it goes, and now on both sides of this engage. There goes our laser guy, our Tychus, the guy that we were talking about a little bit earlier, and it will be
Beto
a trade-up, a one-for-one. We do need that hook, absolutely. Sadoharu is a prime target, has no energy left. The Ancestral Healing is going to be enough. Wrath could not secure that takedown, and now it will be the big attack on top of Sadoharu. He is now going to be out of this fight. Kakisho has no chance except to retreat. He will get off the heal on top of Dan, but that was a phenomenal defense.
So the Tricky Turtles do get a decent amount of fighting happening there, but the Golem was grabbed by the Mad Banners, and you now see a little bit of pressure here in the top lane as Torino is forced to deal with it overall. The rest of the team are currently on the left side of the map here trying to grab a Knight Camp as well, or a Bruiser Camp. This will actually push in the middle lane, so they're trying to set up for that next tribute. But overall, the Mad Banners need to be a little bit more crisp in team fight because they were up one member in that fight. But with the Vikings showing up from behind, they were able to secure a couple of kills. And if Beto can start hitting hooks in this mid game, the Tricky Turtles are definitely in this game.
So level 13 each side. We did just get those next tier of power-ups. Both these teams are feeling really good because they're more or less neck and neck. It's 11 minutes in, but that Golem did some really big work into that top lane. So it might have been a really great defense from the Tricky Turtles by able to turn back a few takedowns to their name, but they did lose out that gate top. That's going to be dangerous later on when we get more Grave Golems on the map.
Let's check the middle lane out. I see a lot of members here for the Mad Banners. They're trying to push down this wall, and while two members are down in the bottom right corner trying to grab those giants, they have potential here to go ahead and go for a push. However, a tribute is spawning very, very soon. The Mad Banners need to figure out what they want to do and do it quickly, and it looks like they may want to grab this Golem. Sneaky.
If they get the top, it's very, very likely you get the bottom. You're going to see that pattern going back and forth, but there's a lot of delay between these two. We do actually have Dan holding down the mid lane, and it's keeping them at bay, which means that we're not going to be foraying into the side lanes here and looking for that kind of aggression. Can we actually take down this Grave Golem before? There's the Farsight from the Rengar, so they know what's up, but they can't stop it. In fact, it's going to be now perhaps even Dan. Wow. That dimensional warp actually goes right through that hook. So that's not going to be a takedown here for the Tricky Turtles, but they might still be able to defend against this tribute.
Dan was a major key in that entire thing. He actually distracted four members of the Tricky Turtles, which allowed for his team to grab that Golem that is now pushing the bottom lane. However, the Tricky Turtles do want to grab a tribute in some way or some form if they can. They're holding it here. RPSD may be able to get it. Beto finally grabs the tribute. They need to pull back, though. They do not want to fight here. They want to defend against this Golem.
And defense, it will be very key here, but it's not going to save out this fort. And this is actually not going to be an engage, or at least an attempt at an engage here from the Mad Banners. If they can fight 5-on-5 with a Golem on their side, it's like you're having a sixth hero there for free. Some of those auto attacks can really hit hard. And the basic attacks from the Golem, he's just going to march on forward. Could we actually still get that engage?
Jester, I want an engage from Beto here now while they're by their turrets. They can get a hook here, even on Kakisho. There we go. There's a hook. Nicely done. However, it hits a Divine Storm on four people. Maj Pit from Wrath is huge as it gets two members. Dan Lee for three in trouble. He will dive into the back left corner, though, going on Mr. Berkers. Can he secure a takedown? No, the teamwork is too good here for the Mad Banners, and he's forced to retreat. He gets taken down to low HP. He does get healed up by his teammate, but Wrath is caught up here in the top right corner, and Dan Lee for three finally secures a kill, maybe another one on Kakisho.
Yeah, the Vikings actually chased down the Tychus. We didn't have that big laser in that team fight. That's a big mistake here from the Banners. So not only did they actually have a really good engage on the Banners because the Uther got hooked in and then that Divine Storm, but unfortunately they just weren't able to turn it around. Monkey Lumps running for the hills, and This actually might have him turn right back around, because this is the potential curse for the Tricky Turtles.
Yeah, the Tricky Turtles want to grab this. They're waiting a little bit. They want to make sure it's maximally efficient to where they can get to another team fight. They want to wait for the opposing team to spawn, and it's about another 3 to 5 seconds before members for the Mad Banners do show up on the map. Now, the Tricky Turtles, with level 16, are going to spread out a little bit. We got the Monkey Lumps here in the middle, going to be pushing up, and we have the Vikings at the bottom. They just secured the fort kill there, and now with the rest of the team heading towards the middle lane, expect a fight here for the Tricky Turtles. They want to get a hook and start an engagement once again.
And if we can keep all of the Mad Banners here into this mid lane, and the top and the bottom will continue pushing out. It's up to Dan Lee here. That's going to be the Storm. Dan Lee does not get hit, and there goes that kill on top of Uther. The takedown is real. The Ancestral on top of Dan Lee is good. He's now going to try to dash forward and look to capitalize on more takedowns. Can it be Wrath? Can it be Mr. Burks? It looks like they will get to the safety of their gates just in time. Dan wasn't there. He's now going to come to their rescue, but can they win a 4-on-5 when they're cursed?
They got to be careful here, because Mr. Burkies does not have his heroic. I don't believe Sada has his heroic as well. Oh, it looks like he does have it up, but still, they need to be careful. There was a hook there from Beta. Chirino gets chunked as well in terms of damage, but the Tricky Turtles overall are playing the smartly. They're getting a couple of takedowns here and there. They're not over-chasing, and they're grabbing objectives. They killed two forts in that last entire tribute, and now they're going in the top right corner and grabbing this golem. The blue team, the Mad Banners, isn't even aware this is happening. They're on the very far left side of the map trying to grab Giants.
And the Siege Giants is a great idea, but if your opponent's disappear and there's a Grave Golem on the map and you don't have a Clairvoyance, you gotta send somebody over there, and it's just not gonna be in the cards here for the Mad Banners. There goes that Grave Golem. It's gonna be marching down top. We're now transitioning here to the Bruisers as well. If the Tricky Turtles starts getting more and more mercenary camps, that's just gonna be putting more and more pressure on Mad Banners, and we might actually start seeing some more ambushes from Tricky Turtles.
So overall, in terms of actual stats, we're looking at it right now. There are 3 forts left here for the Mad Banners. There are 4 left for the Tricky Turtles. 8 takedowns to 7.25. So the game is relatively close. I just need the Mad Banners to clean up their team fight a little bit. In the last couple of team fights, the Tricky Turtles have been just a tad bit better, and we're seeing the result as they're starting to grab map pressure. They're starting to get a lot of their objectives on the field. If they can keep it up, the Tricky Turtles, they can totally take this to the late game and maybe secure a win.
Now, both sides have had curses go their way. It's 0-0 for the tribute count. This next one is still fight worthy, but you don't want to overcommit, especially if you're going to start taking losses. It's not worth it when you're going from 0 to 1. You got to be more concerned when you go from 2 to 3 and you trigger in that curse. Right now, the Tricky Turtles, 19 to almost 18 here from the Banners. That means those Storm tier talents are much, much closer for the Tricky Turtles.
Yeah, the Tricky Turtles are trying to get level 20. You're completely correct if they want to get the Storm Powers. And again, this late game, the strategy is very, very important for both teams. Do you want to grab the tribute when it's not as important? Do you want to push down maybe some turrets if you think the opposing team is across the map trying to grab that tribute? A lot of give and take will be happening here.
Oh, I like
and
this.
Beto, ooh, Beto is trying to get a hook here. You see him moving around. He might be going behind this wall here. Okay, here
we
go.
You use the vision of the Siege Giant to try to capture. If they don't get Kakisho, it could be a kill.
Yeah, Dan actually used his Oracle ability that revealed the area, which actually allowed him to know that Beta was there. So the red team wisely does pull back, especially with the tribute spawning to the 12 o'clock position.
And an ambush isn't an ambush if they know you're there.
Yep. Very, very true. ETC, though, in the middle of the map, it looks like maybe getting in trouble. We'll be pulling back Mr. Burkies.
Oh my gosh,
he gets hooked. This is big here. If they can take out Mr. Burkies, the red team will be in a great position. They catch one member down. Kakisho in trouble as well. Sadaharu is getting picked off by Dan Lee for 3. He's going to be chasing him down there in the top 12 o'clock position. Sadaharu looks like he will be taking down.
Oh.
Overall, the Tricky Turtles do hit level 20 as well. Can they focus down Wrath? That's the important one here. A bit of a missed metamorphosis, but Dayon is in trouble.
Yeah, he doesn't have, you know, an invincibility trick up his sleeve, but he can really make life a lot difficult, and it looks like it's just going to be difficult enough to take him down. He will be a survivor of this engage, but 3 takedowns to 2, you know, with that hook on top of Mr. Burks. That was a phenomenal hit by Battosai, and able to grab that initiative with that level 20. I'm actually really surprised at the tenacity of Mad Banners. They didn't get team wiped here, and they're still able to start cleaning up some more of this aftermath, and that's a big point in their favor.
Yeah, a very important game-changing hook happened there, and now the red team, the Tricky Turtles, are grabbing this golem in the bottom left corner. They were able to secure the tribute on the very top because they have the Vikings that can split up, and it looks like Dan and ETC Wrath here has no idea this golem is being grabbed. This is sneaky, it's bold, but it's gonna work, and I like it.
Yeah, but even if they knew that was going on, a 2-on-5 because of the Vikings right there, it's just not in the cards, not this late game. You need to really be sticking with your team because the power of your team is going to be amplified by the number of teammates that you have around. Solo play is just not really proven statistically to work. So sticking together is what we're seeing here from the Tricky Turtles. As a team, they went and got those golems. And as a team, Mad Banners cleaned up bottom instead of engaging.
Yeah, and right now the Mad Banners in the bottom left corner are dealing with that goal. Their main goal right now is to get even with the Tricky Turtles. They want to make sure they secure level 20. They want to have the same amount of power that they have. So you see them clearing up anything that's being thrown in their lanes. They have these red minions they have to get rid of, and that will award them experience. They're getting it right now. They're very, very close, seconds away from hitting 20. And until then, they will not fight. They want to make sure that when they go into the fight, they all both have the tools to actually win.
Now, this is actually, the timing is really good in favor here of the Mad Banners because they do now have their Storm tier talents. They are ready to go on even playing field, and it's even closer to their side. The problem is I'm not really seeing a lot of, rotation, a lot of interest here from the Mad Banners. They might actually just let this one go and wait for another round in order to do that again.
Yeah, they can afford to let it go. They got to be careful, though. Remember, Beto over here is trying to get a hook with that character. If he can land it on someone important, like Mr. Berkeys or Sadaharu, that might potentially be game for the Mad Banners. So they have to be careful. Dayan taking a lot of damage here, trying to actually get hooked himself. If he can actually waste that cooldown and then use that invincible ability that he has, that Void Shift, he's able to actually negate what Beto can use. So Beto just dancing. This is very intense.
We do have the redemption there on top of Kakisho as well. If he goes down early, that's okay. He's going to come back in fairly short order. He's going to get off his eternal devotion and then come back into the land of the living. There's the hook, but it's on top of Wrath. That's not the target that he wants. Wrath into the back is going to have a concert for Monkey Loves, and that is going to keep him busy. There's no heals coming out from Monkey Loves, but instead, Sadaharu has to deal with Dan Lee 4-3. Just going on and on and on top of her, and now she's going to be taken out. There goes the Illidan there as well. 2-for-2 for the takedowns. Monkey Loves is taking a lot of that laser from the Tychus player, from Mr. Burks, who's now on the retreat. The Vikings are chasing down, and RPSD does get that kill. Here's the Ancestral. Battlesai is going to come right back into this one. Monkey Lumps is still holding on, and here's the Vikings as well. That will clean up Kakisho, and remember, there is a redemption. There is a possibility of hunting him down and taking him down again.
It looks like Wrath may just get away, but he's the only member left here for the Mad Banners to actually survive that entire fight. So with a 2-for-4 trade overall, the red team will be able to secure that tribute we saw earlier, so they now have 2 out of 3. They're spreading out, starting to grab map objectives. Overall, even though they hooked Wrath, which isn't the target you want to hit, they were able to force the Mad Banners to split up just enough where we saw the Vala on the team jump into the fight and really burst down 2 members, and that allowed the fight to just transpire as we saw it. So nicely done by the Tricky Turtles. They're now grabbing this golem in the top right corner, and there's nowhere nearby. Wrath is in the middle of the map, and he's not even close to where this golem is.
But once again, it's a similar situation. Even if he knew what was going on up here, there's nothing he can do about
Agreed.
It. On a 1-to-4-to-5 ratio, the odds are just not good, and I didn't need to go to college for that one.
All right, well, the golem is going to be focused down. Blue team is nowhere near it. Mad Banners instead are going to elect to grab the bruisers down here in the bottom left corner. They're going to try and grab something if they could. Oh, decide to go ahead and pull back because they're not quite sure where their opponents are. Now, finally, with an ability, they're able to reveal that area. So they're going to go ahead and grab this bruiser because they have something. It's a consolation prize. You want to make sure you have some kind of pressure on the map so you can actually deal with that golem in that top left corner because that will be their next target they have to deal with.
Now, so remember once upon a time, Trixler, this top lane, it lost out its gate during a curse, and it said, you know, there's going to be a big Grave Golem coming down that lane. Look at this! There's a big Grave Golem now coming down from the opposite side. So had this actually worked out a little bit better earlier for the Mad Banners, they might not be dealing with this, but Tricky Turtles, they have a big opportunity to start grabbing some takedowns here.
And the Mad Banners, they have to defend this. They know that. And looks like the Tricky Turtles are being sneaky. They're being a little tricky, if you will. They're heading down to this giant in the top left corner.
Yeah, while tribute.
They have 1 member down in the bottom right corner grabbing the tribute.
And this here's will, the curse.
Yep, it'll cause a curse, and that'll allow the Tricky Turtles to actually fully push this top lane if they would like to, but instead they're looking to go ahead in the middle lane. They're trying to find a way to get the Mad Banners to kind of sneak around and move into weird areas so they can get those hooks that are so important to their success.
So the Grave Golem has marched down. Neither team has a top keep gate anymore. Another Grave Golem going either way could actually start landing some really massive damage, especially since it's 23 minutes in. Now, these Grave Golems keep getting stronger, these minions keep getting stronger, and so do these players. 21 to 22 in 23 minutes. Love how that actually lines up, and the power is very real here from the Tricky Turtles. They have all the pressure, and they have this curse. It's up to them to make the most of it.
All right, so I'm watching Wrath and Kakishko right now. They are the two important members for the Mount Banners that can defend this correctly. They need to use Wrath to maybe dive into the Tricky Turtles in some way or some form and start their amazing heroics that can stun out a number of players. They want to hit Chirino if possible, as that player is a lot of the damage.
Yeah, the Vala, again, big mainstay into the bag. If you can't take her down, she will start hitting you with those double crossbows. And that is not something that you want. There's the hook, but it lands on top of Dan. And there's that dimensional shift as well. He gets out of the danger zone. We'll live to see another day. And he said, you know, the ETC, he wants to get in there for that mosh pit. As long as he voluntarily gets hooked, half the work is now done for him.
Yeah, you're totally correct there. And even with, I want to know, every time Beto does miss a hook on an important member, you see them all pull back and get to a weird scenario.
Oh, here it is.
Wrath, though, does charge in. He's going to use his mosh pit. He's going to be able to get two people to dance, but Chirino is actually able to disrupt it. Chirino, though, gets bursted down immediately here for the Mad Banners. Dan Lee for three is chasing down Sadaharu. Look at Kisho. Dayan and Sadaharu are doing such great teamwork overall. It looks like they may be able to survive just a little bit longer, but Dan Lee for three is completely is constantly keeping going. He's not stopping. He's trying to help out with the damage. With some damage from Sadaharu, though, Monkey Lumps and Dan Lee for three are forced to retreat. Can they keep fighting this?
Well, they're definitely going to try, but this is going to be a big mistake. Here comes the Viking Boat, and RPSD is really doing the damage. Once more into the ethereal form will be that Uther, and Dan, he has to get out of this. Sadaharu even sprinting away from the danger. Uther, you see him trucking back to his team, but that was really just a big overextension.
Yeah, it certainly was, and it looked like at first they were going to win that team fight because Wrath got off a really good Maj Pit, the heroic ability that he has that's able to stun a number of people that are dancing around him. But Chirino, the Vala player, disrupted that, and that threw the entire fight into the favor of Tricky Turtles. Now, with that advantage they have because of their player, even though they lost the Vala player, they're able to grab this Golem. This Golem will now push in the bottom lane and push into a lane that has no keep, by the way, which is a big deal.
And that's the big danger of some of these early pushes in the top, in the bottom, for both sides. Whoever grabs these Grave Golems, especially later into the match, it's just a powerhouse big siege vehicle that's going to start marching down, and that's going to put your core in danger. And ultimately, you need to protect your core if you want to continue to fight in these battlegrounds.
Totally true here. And the Mad Banners are going to do that. They're going to deal with this Golem and, of course, the minions, as the Tricky Turtles are actually all over the map. And the top lane, they have their Chirino player, Vala, pushing in the lane, trying to keep the pressure up. In the middle, they have the Giants being grabbed by the Illidan, and of course, Beto Cid, and then they have the Vikings grabbing these Bruisers. They're getting everything they can on the battleground here just to keep up all the pressure, because they know the next tribute will be pretty important for them.
And, you know, speaking of that pressure, I mean, so many of these camps have now been taken by the Tricky Turtles. So not only are they ahead in terms of the experience, they got those takedowns, they got the levels, but Chirino was pushing down the top lane. Now she's taking these Siege Giants. Siege Giants and Bruisers and Grave Golems. Oh my, this is totally 100% a great situation for the Tricky Turtles.
All right, so Jester, I got to ask you, as the Mad Banners, what do you do to come back from here? You get the lanes pushed out, and then what do you do?
Well, their team fighting is not that bad. I mean, they have a really good wombo combo setup, a really good 1-2 punch if you would,
sure,
if you go with that. The lasers have been really on point from Tychus, but unfortunately, Wrath sometimes gets a little bit too far away from the team, and the rest of them can't really follow up on top of some of these fantastic mosh pits. The laser at this point with level 20 has a huge radius, so that's actually a problem that solved itself with the storm tier talents. But coming into this, I mean, Uther cannot be afraid to get down and dirty with Wrath. I think that's what they're going to need, a really good mosh pit 1-2 punch combo.
Oh no, Dan does get caught here. If he is taken out, this could be potentially the end of the game for the Mad Banners. Luckily, he's able to pull back. Wrath, Mr. Berkey, Sadahiro, Kakisho, and Dayan. The Mad Banners are pushing forward a little bit. They do want to get into a fight, and they know they need to do it because they are on a timer. Right now, in the middle lane and in the bottom lane, their core is being attacked by minions. We'll go ahead and check that out in a second here, but it looks like Dan Lee for three is charging in. Okay, he is going to be forced to retreat.
Oh, wow.
A beautiful hook. It is on Wrath. It's not a hero you want, but hey, that's A-okay. If you take out one member, we're good to go.
No follow-up.
Wrath is done here. He's going to be taken out. Let's go ahead and check out the base as after we watch Wrath be fallen out. Look, it's already lost a quarter of health.
Yep.
That was from minions being pushed in the middle lane and the bottom lane. Gotta be careful.
Yeah, so Rath, unfortunately, is just kind of left to his own devices. He will not be able to come back in any quick amount of time. And as you said, 65% on that court. That was a free third of it right there, simply because we were not at home defending. This is the problem when you don't have keeps, those catapults. And at the same time, we had so many mercenary camps being captured by the Tricky Turtles. One more to add to that as well. This actually could be either that top keep and game, but at the very least, it's still a lot of pressure for the Mad Banners to deal with.
Yeah, it looks like the Tricky Turtles don't even want to really deal with a tribute that just spawned in the very far bottom right. They're going to push the top lane. I think this is the better choice. They have a huge, meaty golem that's very robust that can help them break down this last keep up in the top left corner. A hook, though, goes on Kikisho. The Divine Storm is pretty nice there. We will have Dion go in for the engagement. They're trying to focus down Monkey Lumps, but he heals up immediately here. Sadaharu is in trouble as Dan Lee for three is pushing down. Could this be the end of the game, Jester?
Well, the laser went down. It's already out. There's still no Wrath. He's still returning to the game, which means it's a 5-on-4. We don't have the power here for this defense, and now we do. But it's going to be the hook on top of Burks, and look at how quickly he is taken down. The Tigers is out of this equation, and this is a very angry Grave Golem now working on a core that doesn't have the hit points.
The rest of the Mad Banners are trying their best to defend, but unfortunately will not be able to do so as the Tricky Turtles will secure the first win in this series.
Congratulations to them. A lot of pressure that the Mad Banners had to deal with in that late game. The Tricky Turtles, I mean, they really capped off that kind of pressure. It might not have been the most takedowns that we've ever seen, although with 21 by the end of it, it's definitely one of the highest that I think we've seen now in Heroes of the Dorm.
Yeah.
But just pressure everywhere. That was the name of their game. Not only with the Vikings in different lanes, but the Tricky Turtles with so many mercenary camps by the end of it all. That secures them 1-0.
I'm really proud of the Mad Banners of doing a really solid job of making sure to try and get Wrath to jump into things. But the thing is the Tricky Turtles always did a good job of making the ETC player, the one that had the mosh pit dancing, they disrupted him every single time. It always looked like the Mad Banners had some way or some form to actually get a good fight off, but unfortunately, the Tricky Turtles were just on point. They knew who to deal with, and then as soon as they dealt with it, they followed up correctly. Mm-hmm. Nicely done.
The only one that really got off that full duration was when he was by himself.
Yeah.
And unfortunately,
it was cute.
It was great. It was a great concert, and everyone attended, and they asked for an encore. And eventually, 60 seconds later, we had one, but it was just not enough for Wrath, and he couldn't defend.
Just not enough. Well, we do have a couple of replays for you guys to go ahead and check out what happened in that map, some of the crazy game changers. One's really important here, the Rhaegar. Watch Monkey Lumps as he's going to hit a really important ancestral healing on his teammate. You see Dan Lee for three charging in, really taking out a lot of damage, very close to death. He's pulling back all the way, but the heal almost down to 100 HP. Dan Lee for three gets healed all the way up. Now they're able to deal with Wrath pretty effectively. Remember, he's a displacement tank in this fight, and Kikisho, now left by himself, just gets picked off. So nicely done here by Monkey Lumps. Beautiful MVP play right there.
Yeah, skin of his teeth. And going into this one, again, you're going to be looking at Monkey Lumps looking to support this team. Wrath goes in. He only catches Monkey Lumps, which means he's not healing the team. You can see the big radius of that laser doing the damage, but where is the Monkey Lumps? There's Sadaharu is actually going to drop. Dan not looking so hot, but there it is. And that heal right there keeps everyone ready to go. RPSD doing just so much damage, and gotta say, a credit to the Rhaegar players out there. Monkey Lumps did fantastic. There's the heal again. Battlesign is gonna stay up. Monkey Lumps really low. Heal again. Keeps himself up, and Kakaisho just does not have the tool set to do anything about it.
Yeah, the support's making the plays in this fight, and I do want to commend Chirino also in the beginning of that fight as well. He dived in, made sure to take out two members really quickly before he was taken down, and then, of course, with Monkey Lumps and the teamwork overall for the red team, they were able to take that match pretty decisively. So well done overall for the Mad Banners. You know, the game was really, really close. I want to see them be a little bit more passive with their aggressive play, if that makes any sense. Be aggressive, maybe bait out a couple of abilities, and then get into a team fight, because they seem to be being outplayed just by a tad bit.
Just a little. I would still say I'm not entirely too sure how this series will go, because now it's going to be the pick for the Mad Banners as they go into match number two. We're going to take a quick break, but when we return, match number two will be on Sky Temple. So do your homework, come on back, watch Heroes of the Dorm, because game number two is coming at you in just a few.